We've already spent a lot of time thinking about how awesome carbon is for life, that really life as we know it is carbon-based. And this all comes out of carbon's ability to bond with other carbons and form all sorts of neat structures, bonds with oxygen, hydrogens, and other things. In fact, we have a whole class of molecules called organic molecules that just are molecules that involve carbon. And carbon's bonding capabilities really come out of its electron structure. And we talked about this in a previous video. But if we think about carbon, it has 6 protons, and a neutral carbon will have 6 electrons. 2 of them are sitting in its innermost shell, and then the other 4 on its outermost shell, and those 4 are the ones that tend to react, and we call them the valence electrons. And so these valence electrons tend to form 4 covalent bonds. For example, if you wanted a bond with 4 hydrogens, well, each hydrogen would contribute an electron to one of these pairs, which are essentially going to be a covalent bond. And then the hydrogens can feel that their outer shell is complete, because hydrogen's just trying to get to 2 to fill its outer shell, to try to be a little bit more like helium. And carbon is trying to get to 8 in its outer shell, to be a little bit more like neon. Neon has 2 in its inner shell, 8 in its outer shell. You might remember the octet rule, that atoms try to get to 8, or pretend like they have 8 electrons in their outer shell to feel stable. And here, carbon is sharing 8 electrons. It contributed 4, and then the 4 hydrogens contributed 4, and it forms methane. Now, those of you who are quite astute might have said, okay, well, you know what, I know of other elements that tend to form 4 covalent bonds that have 4 valence electrons. And in particular, there's one that's awfully close to carbon on the periodic table. And that's right over here. This is silicon. Silicon has 14 protons, and a neutral silicon would have 14 electrons. And so let me draw that. So if we have silicon right over here, I'm just going to focus on the electrons. You would have 2 electrons sitting in its innermost shell. And they're jumping around here. They're not these neat, well-defined orbits. They're jumping around in that lowest energy in that innermost shell. And then you have another 8 in its second shell. So 1, I'll just draw them, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, all jumping around in the second shell. And it has a total of 14, so we already used up 10, so it's going to have 4 in its outermost shell. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and these 4 in its outermost shell, these are the ones that tend to do the reacting, we call them valence electrons. So if we wanted to just draw the valence electrons, we could do silicon has 4 valence electrons. 4 has 4, 1, 2, 3, 4 valence electrons, just like carbon. It has a different number of electrons. These 4 valence electrons are actually 1 shell further out, but it has 4 that tend to react, and it does tend to form 4 covalent bonds. So you might be saying, well, can't we have life that is dependent, that is silicon-based as opposed to carbon-based? And if you thought that, you would not be the first person to think about that. Science fiction authors have theorized that, and this is a screenshot from The Devil in the Dark episode, 1967, from the original Star Trek, where they said, hey, the Enterprise encounters these creatures that are silicon-based. They're called hordas, and they have all sorts of interesting properties. So there's some folks who like to think maybe silicon. But when you actually look at the chemistry, things start to break down a little bit. For example, one of the neat things about carbon is it readily forms bonds with other carbons. And then these bonds can actually be quite long. You can form all sorts of these hydrocarbons and all sorts of other carbon-carbon structures with long chains of carbon. So you can do that with carbon. But it turns out that silicon-silicon bonds are not that strong, and silicon is not going to form really long chains. So silicon's not going to do that. Even if you look at a simple molecule like methane, there is a molecule called silane, but this does not readily form, and it does not have the same characteristics. So this is also not going to be as good as methane. And even if you think about something like carbon dioxide, which is carbon bonded, having 2 double bonds. So this is carbon having 2 double bonds to oxygens. So two, so one double bond to one oxygen, another double bond to another oxygen. And we're used to thinking about carbon dioxide in our everyday life as a gas. Plants are using these to fix into their structure, to actually grow. They're taking the carbon out of it, their carbon fixation. We exhale this carbon dioxide. It's essential to life. And you might think, well, what about silicon oxide? And silicon oxide is actually a fairly common molecule, fairly common compound, but it does not exist in a gaseous state at the temperatures that we normally associate with life. Most of silicon oxide is in the form of quartz in the ground. So that is quartz over there. So when you look at the actual ways that silicon forms bonds, it actually does not seem actually close to as good as carbon. And you know, something like silicon, when silicon bonds with oxygen, it's a much, not only is it in the solid form at normal temperatures, where we normally associate life, but these are very, very, very strong bonds, much stronger than the bonds that carbon is forming with oxygen. They're so strong that it'd make it hard for them to be manipulated with the types of chemical reactions that we're used to seeing inside of organisms. So, you know, it's fun to theorize about this, and I'd be the last person to rule anything out. I think the universe will continue to surprise us with things that right now we cannot even imagine, but based on the chemistry we know and based on life as we know it. Even though silicon can form these four covalent bonds and does have four valence electrons, it's still nowhere near as good at carbon as in doing the types of processes that we think are necessary for life.